graffiti or tagging. Like hip-hop music and dance, graph painting evolved in the Bronx and thrived in Queens, Brooklyn and Harlem. But it didn't stay there. The practice of tagging trains transported hip-hop's uncompromising, in-your-face attitude and placed it before an unsuspecting new audience downtown.
The first thing that I noticed coming to New York, I came here in 1978, going to work in Wall Street of all places, chemical bank, a credit analyst. I would go and get in the subway and about to get on a train, and these trains would go by with these amazing burners, you know, graffiti burners, multicolored, you know, name tags that would take up the whole train. And I would watch them go by and just think, my God, this is amazing. And it was the first tug, the first pull into that subculture was, I would have to say, aerosol art or graffiti art.
Having previously been regarded as an eyesore and a public nuisance, graffiti was now making headway as an accepted art form in Manhattan's trendy downtown galleries and studios. In the early 1980s, one of the first graffiti artists to find favor was Fab Five Freddy.
I began to move on the downtown scene in Lower Manhattan and began to meet some of the main people on the downtown new wave scene, new wave punk rock scene. I became close friends with Chris Stein and Deborah Harry, main people in the group Blondie. They would commission me and they bought paintings for me. And I'd say, you know, Debbie. Well, the first line of the rap was Fab Five Freddy told me everybody's fly. DJ spinning, I said my, flash is fast, flash is cool.
Fab Five Freddy, who used to come to my parties all the time, was a good friend of Blondie. And he had always told me that he would bring her to the Bronx. And one time he did, chance to meet her. Next thing I know, I heard this crazy rap record by her, my name in it. Cool.
And then I used to have a rap that I used to do about how I was born and raised on the planet Mars. I used to chill and rock with the stars till one day I got bored and decided to split. I came to Earth on a rocket ship. So when I heard her rapping and she was like, and the man from Mars, and he shoots you dead and eat you. It was just so crazy. You see me later as she begins to move around the set, and me and my partner Lee Quinones are on the back wall, kind of like pseudo dancing, pseudo painting. It was pretty cool, actually.
Whereas Rapper's Delight had principally been a regional hit in the New York area, Blondie's Rapture reached the number one position on the U.S. national chart.
I guess for a lot of the white mainstream public, it was the first time that they heard anybody rap. And it kind of paved the way, you could say, for what was about to come.
In the 70s, hip-hop had taken hold on the fringes of New York. But in 1981, Blondie's hip-hop homage, Rapture, had reached the number one position on the US pop chart. People who'd never heard the music before were curious about where it came from. Hip-hop music was now becoming fashionable in the one area of New York where it had never been accepted before, the discos and nightclubs of downtown Manhattan. The man most responsible for this trend was the graffiti artist who'd inspired Rapture, Fab Five Freddy.
The owner of the Mud Club, which was a very famous club in downtown Manhattan scene at the time, had asked me to curate a show of graffiti. And for that exhibition, I put together, you know, a group of some of the dopest heads from the Bronx that were making it happen, you know. Bambaataa, Cold Crush, Fantastic, Jazzy Five MCs. And the crowd loved it.
just what Bambaataa was playing as a DJ completely blew me away.